I think we need to stretch, make this stretch menu.
Started what? Already?
Tell. So we are here with Marianne. What's your surname now?
Marianne Lobo.
Marianne Lobo. Used to be Borges.
I used to be Borges.
I know your dad and all very well. And you're on this unusual thing of edible plants.
Edible plants and trees.
What does it mean?
Okay. So, well, lockdown got everyone thinking about where they can get resources from without going to the market. And seeing so many things available in nature and knowing the background through Ayurveda, I thought, why not look for it for myself? And that's how this journey started, by finding edible plants and edible trees for myself. And that's when some of my patients said, Doctor, why don't you start doing walks?
You've done your degree in Ayurveda.
I've done my degree in Ayurveda.
B-A-M-S?
B-A-M-S, Ayurveda. Bachelor of Ayurvedic Medicine and Surgery.
I see. Very interesting. So now, walks, how does that...
Okay, so the walks basically just started as in just learning from nature, connecting with nature. And the walks actually help us identify which are the plants that we can use for food or medicine, as well as external medicine and which can be applied. And of course, some little bit of edible flowers along the way.
What's that in your hands?
Okay. This is so famous here in Goa, this season.
Yeah.
This is called as uski, from which you get the uskechi mati. What you use for the coconut plant in the rainy season.
Supposed to be very fertile, no? Uskechi mati.
Yes, the uskechi mati is very fertile. Now, very few people know that certain tribal medicine, the ladies use the tender leaves of these as a deworm.
I see.
Okay, and you can also give the tender leaves of this plant as a deworm to the animals.
I see.
And it is also called like a midwife, because it takes care of nature just like how a midwife would look after a child. And they say, there's a very, again, a folk saying that if you cut through tender leaves,
yeah,
you will get some kind of a liquid which will sustain you if you're in the forest and you're thirsty.
I see.
So that's why it's called as uski.
I see. Very interesting. Of course, I know your interest in plants from your very tender years, maybe going back 20, 25 years, when I was your dad's friend.
Yes.
And he had about 120, 140 varieties of plants in your house in Asagaon.
Yes.
So that was where your interest started, Miriam?
Yes, that's where my interest started. And I can say from a very young age, even before that, my grand aunt, who was a nurse, a retired nurse.
Your dad's or mother's side?
My mother's side. And I used to be left with her because my parents used to go to teach.
Yeah.
And she used to practice natural medicine. Now she
where
gave this? In Asagaon. She gave this one lathe where people would actually, the carpenters and the laborers would come in, because that lathe that she gave.
Lathe means?
A particular kind of a paste. Yes. So the paste that you apply would help heal fractures and pulled ligaments and stretched ligaments, like sprain in their joints and things like that. So she would give it specifically on the full moon time and things like that. So there were a lot of people that were just lined up waiting there collect a
This healing happens on the full moon time?
Some bit of it, yes.
I see.
Yes, some bit of it does happen. And then the full moon, of course, has a lot of role to play in our emotions, mind, body, soul, spirit.
Yeah.
So there is a lot of connection between this.
Because of the water connect, because our body.
Because of the water, because of the magnetic pull on the earth at that particular moment being the strongest. So there is a lot of things, including the waves, the tides. And they do affect our human psychology and the way we react to situations. So we can't negate that effect on us in our life. And even on the life of the wildlife and the plants.
Yeah. So just to interrupt, for those who came in late, we are talking to Marianne Borges Lobo, who is an Ayurvedic doctor. And now, just 3 months back, her husband was telling me that you all have launched this edible plants walk.
Yes,
edible plants walk.
And also we'll be starting the foraging trips very soon, where we will forage plants as well as cook them at a particular place. So there will be a foraging trip with lunch ready.
My goodness, amazing.
So,
yeah,
yes, so just amazing. Beginning to introduce these few concepts. These concepts
very interesting, very innovative, and I really hope that you know you can take it further.
Yes,
but today maybe we'll go for a little walk around this place. For we've not introduced it actually. This is the Pilen bird watching point, the Savlia Lake in Pilen. Okay, and I mean the sun is against us at this point of time, but it's a very scenic place. And my environmental friends were telling me that at one stage, you know, the builders and politicians wanted to build all over it, but they managed to block them and things like that. So, Savlia Lake in Pilen. And we'll just walk around a little bit and see where we reach and what we find.
Yes.
Please. Yeah.
So, right here, as we can see, is the Indian Sarsaparilla. Now this is a very lesser known herb, but those who have been to Kerala and have had a brown decoction like tea just before food, especially during the summer season, may know what the decoction is. But this is the plant from which the decoction is derived. Now the decoction made from this plant is very cooling, as well as it is Pitta Shamak, as we say. So people who have Pitta Prakriti, the decoction of this root would really help them. It is also as good as an antacid. It's good for white discharge, as well as, you know, those who suffer from extra uterine bleeding. Now, a very unique property of this root is it is very cooling even if applied externally. So for those who don't want to use powders and deodorants, use this along this powder of this root along with sandalwood powder under your arms and on the body if you want to smell nice and good.
Interesting, very interesting. Now it's so amazing that there is this pharmacy, this treasure house, this well under our feet, as it were, and we are not even aware of it.
Now, as many know, Goa is a place known for alcohol, and there are so many alcoholics, and many, of course, suffer from liver problems.
Yeah.
Now, this particular plant, the leaves of this
are very good.
This is acai, as it is called in local language. And, of course, they have beautiful berries that come in from the month of October to January. And the berries are consumed too by many children without actually knowing that even the leaves have medicinal properties. So anybody suffering from an alcoholic liver, jaundice, even herpes, if you just boil these leaves plain in water, do 1/8 reduction, that is about, you know, bring it to about 800 ml.
Yeah.
And if you can consume this on a daily basis, you will have the liver regenerate like anything within about a month.
Shucks.
So this is nature's pharmacy.
Oh gosh.
So beautiful. Huh?
Yeah. So amazing. I mean, like, okay, beauty is in the eye of the beholder.
Now, if you see this one on top,
yeah,
this is again a lovely, really nice plant. Both the one here and here.
Yeah.
Okay. This is nature's toothbrush.
I see.
Okay. This the bark of this plant, the branches from this plant are used to brush teeth. Many people know only you use babool.
Yeah.
Okay. As a mango leaves as nature's toothbrush. Now the branches, the smaller branches of these, are used as nature's toothbrush.
What's it called?
It's a Mimisop silengi or bakul. Let's see if we can find some of it.
Careful, huh? Careful.
Yes. So,
fruit?
Here we have its flowers. The fruit has yet to come.
I see.
This is the flowers. It's very fragrant.
You
can smell it.
Ratrani?
No, this is bakul. This is wona, as they say. Wola. And no wedding in Goa or around is complete without the mala being the garland exchanged between the bride and the groom of this.
I see.
So this comes in this particular season of spring because this is a season of young love. It's the season, you know, Valentine's Day is just one day, but in India, young love is celebrated for a whole season of spring.
And the wedding season also.
So these are, that's how, you know, there's so many things. You can use them in your bedroom, you can use them in your dining room, in your hall, just to spread natural fragrance.
I see.
Why do we need the air fresheners when we have such beautiful flowers in nature?
True.
And that's how you get them.
Kanla Ola, that's a program also, the Konkani musical program, which is named after this flower.
After this flower, exactly.
I used to always wonder what that was.
So
because
here you go, more of them. And you'll see ladies normally picking them up in the morning.
I see.
And the fruits of it, of course, as I mentioned earlier, you get the fruits a little later.
Yeah.
The fruits are a very good antioxidant. And they look a little smaller than Adam fruit, Adam's fruit.
Yeah, yeah.
So they are very good. They have multi vitamins into them. And they also help build up our immunity and protect us against the fevers that will happen during the rainy season.
Adam used to be all over the place at one stage.
Yes.
Now it's virtually extinct. No,
yes.
Now you hardly find
it. It is like a delicacy, like caviar to get it now.
And the price has shot up like through the roof, like,
yes.
No?
Yes, exactly.
I think a lot of trees have been cut also, the Adam.
A lot have been cut.
You really need a sharp eye and a lot of gray cells in your brains to recognize
exactly,
this.
I guess somehow the love for nature. Now this one is a very small plant of something called as Saptaparna.
Okay. Saptam means seven?
Saptam means seven. So basically what you can see here, because they're very tender, you'll only see six.
I see.
Now this is called as a devil's tree.
I see.
It's very interesting. If anybody has been near Maldi, Goa,
yeah,
we'll see two trees on either side of the highway. And they're extremely sweet smelling. And that's why it's called as devil's tree, because the spirits like sweet smell. So in the night, we were told, our adults told us, the grandparents and grand-aunts told us, never to go under this tree because there would be spirits on this tree. So that's why the name devil's tree.
I see.
Now, coming back to its medicinal property, it is very good for COVID. And very good for fighting seasonal infections and fevers. So if you have it in the month of May, children do not suffer from fever during the rainy season.
I see.
Now it's that good. It's also called as the Indian cheesewood tree. Many people here locally will know it as Satingo. The reason it is, you use the bark of it just before Diwali.
I see.
On the Diwali day, you have the bath and you have the decoction of this bath. Why? It purifies your entire system for the onslaught of the sweets. That's what it does. So you don't get a sweet attack.
I see. So when you take these people on tours, you find invariably wherever you go, you're finding all these kind of strange.
Yes.
You have no problem in finding them.
I don't have any problem in finding them because, you know, there's one saying, very much in Ayurveda,
yeah,
that there was a teacher, a student asked his teacher, sir, in this rate, everything is useful.
Yeah.
So the teacher told him, why don't you go around and just have a look? So he was sent on an errand of finding what plant was not useful. And he goes searching. And he comes back with the answer saying, sir, I found that nothing was not useful. Everything had some use or the other.
Gosh. So your tour's gone for how long?
It lasts about 1.5 hours.
Yeah.
But generally it does go on a little more because everyone is so excited by then to know so much. And it's lovely when kids come because kids bring their own unique charm to this box.
So what are the kind of audiences you're attracting as of now?
At the moment, the audiences...
Serious people, curious people?
Yeah, serious people, curious people, nature lovers. I've had also people that... Chefs that have come in, architects. And then someone who started a food forest.
I see.
So he came also specially for this walk. And you know, it's really nice. I have people who are also having their own sustainability and conservation products, projects coming. So it's really, really nice.
Fascinating concept. And I think you all guys are really adding value to...
And how can I forget this little plant?
I see.
Of course, it's too small.
Yeah.
So this is the Kanta. The Kanta berry.
It's a big tree actually. No?
Yes, it's a big tree. So let's see if we can spot its
parent.
Yes.
So this is actually, Pilen is so close to the highway and the city. But still it is, there are parts of it which are green. Parts of it supplying water and things like that.
Yes.
To the urban sprawl. Of course that's the
you know what's that?
Yeah. Just now we said it, no? I forgot. In between your Billomad.
So Billomad, now do you know that it contains a very unique flower? Everybody knows that it is used for festa.
Yeah.
Okay, from Goa to Sri Lanka, the leaves are used for every celebrating occasion.
Yeah.
Even in Sri Lanka, for the Buddhist festivals, none of them will be complete without the use of these leaves.
I see.
But it happened because you use it for feast, because it also has a very medicinal value. The pith of it is boiled and dried, and then a powder extracted, which looks like a flour.
I see.
So that is used. Now, it is very cooling for the body. So if you have a gruel or a kanji made of this flour in the morning, you will not get a heat stroke.
I see.
And it's especially during this season.
Now,
there are many villages in Mangalore, rural Mangalore, that you will still get this flour available. It is not available in the commercial market.
I see.
So, very sad that Goans have forgotten its use. But, you know, people in Mangalore and down south are still using it.
And, of course, kids take the hair from it and call it elephant's hair.
Yes.
And make bangles and all kinds of things in school.
All sorts of things,
exactly. We used to play with that. No, very boyish kind of thing. So.
And how can we forget our Sanjivao Koppel without some leaves of it?
Sanjivao Koppel?
Yes.
Ah, the leaves hanging down?
The leaves also are there put along with the flowers.
I see.
In the Koppel.
I see. So some figures, Marianne, how many medicinal plants would there be in Goa, any estimate? Oops, we are in the light.
Maybe, roughly, according to me now, currently, we should have 1,000 plus varieties.
I see.
But when I was a student, I knew there was many, many more, especially in the Ponda region. But with so much of development and urbanization coming in, I myself have seen personally 40 species lost.
I see.
So this has been a great pain for me personally, because I grew up seeing these plants and I know the coming generation would not even have access to these plants. So one of my aims, the ultimate aims of the walk, is if people could know what the plants are and develop a love, then we wouldn't want to kill these plants. Or at least we would think before doing something in that area to relocate these plants.
Yeah.
Before, you know, we...
When Father Pratap was there in the Thomas Stevens Kopni Kendra, he had plants, about 125 varieties or
something
like that.
Yes,
all named and neatly...
Very neatly done and things
but
like
but
that.
But there's a lack of knowledge. I mean,
yes.
You know.
Now, I don't know if the camera will be able to capture. That is the Satango plant, actually.
I see.
That's how big and erect it grows.
I see.
So you will see 7 leaves on that.
I see.
So that's the devil's tree.
I see. Whoops. Interesting. Very interesting. So you did your Ayurvedic studies in Ponda, Shiroda.
Ponda, Shiroda, yes. Which was loaded and having so many medicinal plants. There was even one medicinal plant which was actually used in snake poison. Today that tree is not there anymore.
I see.
So that's
what's
why
it, called?
It is called a Sirish.
I see.
Albizia Lebec.
I see.
Okay, so this was, you know, why I feel the pain. Because I know these plants were there and they were so useful and that they are no more there. Now this one...
Yeah.
Everyone knows it as a poison tree. But do you know that homeopathy and Ayurveda both together use it as a medicine?
Which is it? What's
so this is... Any idea what it could be called in
no,
local
Datura,
language?
Datura, no.
No. You're very close. But
I see.
The distinguishing of this plant is very much in its bark.
I see.
If you notice...
Yeah.
Its bark is a bit, brownish oranges.
Yeah. I see. Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
So this one now here, of course, the kazaro is there, which I will talk about it being the poison plant. But this one over here is one of the trifala.
I see.
So everybody knows Ayurvedic medicine talks about trifala, right?
Which is
amla, hirda and behda, or amlaki, haritaki, vibitaki.
I see.
Now this is one of them that is of the trifala.
Yeah.
And in Konkani it is called as goting.
I see goting. I've heard of it.
You've heard of it, right?
Many
people's childhood is not complete without eating this goting. You remember that you were told in childhood that you just eat 3 or 4
you'll
or
die.
Maximum 5. No, because otherwise you get intoxicated.
Intoxicated?
Yes.
You get a high?
You get a high after you eat these
My
foods.
Goodness.
So you just have to have 4 or 5 of these.
I see.
So you'll see them all over the place.
Yeah.
And you know, they just consume in very little amounts.
What a treasure chest, but this is not exceptional. No? If we go to any area, we'll find this?
You will find
more
it.
More or less?
The Beheda you will find in a lot of areas. Sukkur has it, Aldona Nashnola have it. Of course, you know, many people do not know its value, so they have been cutting down these plants.
I see.
So that's the sad part of it. Really
very interesting,
sad part.
Very
so this is, as you can see, the big nice leaves.
Yeah.
That's the Vibitaki.
I see.
So that's one of the sisters of the Amlaki, Vibitaki, Haritaki.
I see. My goodness.
Of course. And now here is the poison plant.
I see.
Which is also called as kazro.
Kazro.
You must
the leaves
be,
or what?
The seed of it.
Seed.
It if it is consumed,
yeah,
it causes a like tetanus.
Really?
So the body arcs.
Really?
But if it is purified, as Ayurvedic doctors and homeopathic doctors know, it is used for central nervous system disorders.
I see.
So the very area it causes that, it causes, it's beneficial when it is purified for the humans.
Fascinating. There's so much we can do, it will never finish, but maybe we should head backwards,
yes,
also.
Yes.
But
and
then,
even this one here.
The coconut has any ply uses?
Oh my, the coconut, who can start and finish with the coconut? Coconut has got so many uses, but especially this season, one thing we will say, it's very cooling.
Yeah.
Of course, for the body. It's Pitta Shamak, it's very good for women. Now, I tell women, especially those who have menstrual disorders, to consume a coconut, a tender coconut specifically, 5 days before their menstrual cycle.
Juice or the?
The juice, the tender coconut and the cream, both can be had.
How much?
It helps aid a good menses.
I see.
So you can have just one a day. That's good enough.
I see.
Yes. And of course, who can finish telling the uses of its oil and extra virgin coconut oil?
Yeah.
It's good for thyroid. More specifically, even I know of so many cases of people who have come off thyroid medicine by only taking extra virgin coconut oil.
In what form?
Just simple, the extra virgin coconut oil. Just
how
having
much?
It. About 2 tablespoons. I myself was a hypothyroid person,
I
can vouch for
really?
This. That yes, that it does
wow.
help thyroid. Now, be careful that you monitor your readings.
Yeah.
So, let's not say it very openly and, you know, because many people will say, how can you go on camera and say it?
Yeah.
So, that's why I'll say, monitor your readings, keep them in check. Exercise, sleep in time, because these are the things that help thyroid to increase in the body. Stress, anxiety, lack of sleep, modern lifestyles where we go to sleep late, the late working hours,
true,
is what increases thyroid.
Talking about the medicinal practices of Goa, no, I once came across a very interesting historian called Dr. I'll get his name. So this guy was actually a historian who was looking at the manifest of ships taking medicinal plants from Goa to Portugal in the 16th century.
Wow!
And trying to track, he's written a paper on it.
Wow.
Trying to track down what were the medicines that the Portuguese learned from a Goan Indian context in those days.
Because it could have been huge. I mean, the amount of, all even now with so much of deforestation and so much of, you know, cutting down and urbanization of this place, and if we still have so many medicinal plants, I'm just thinking, and that time people were so aware and attuned. I am told in Asigao, there was this one lady who people would come to her bringing them cobra venom.
I see.
Patients that had been bitten by the cobra. And she would give a preparation of medicines and none of them died.
I see.
And this was before anti-snake venom was discovered.
I see.
But then sad to say, these things died
out
with her. It went with her to the grave.
Oh gosh.
So that's why I'm trying to cover, speak to older people, get these things. And of course, Rasa, come to the side.
So that the historian was Dr. Timothy Walker, if you Google for him online. No?
Okay.
And maybe I'll search for his paper and put you in touch with him or whatever.
Yes, that would be lovely. And you know, I mean, this was so much there.
Hmm.
So if we could save this kind of knowledge.
People are willing to share it. People are willing to share
there
it.
There are some that are willing to share. Of course, some people just say, why do you want to know? It's something that we just keep it in the family. And
which is understandable. I mean, there are different approaches to knowledge. And,
there
you know,
is different approaches because there has been so much of exploitation.
Yeah.
And they don't
I
want
can understand
them.
That. Yeah.
Yes. So as you can
and
see here, see another plant. Another two plants of the Sarsaparilla.
I see.
Just growing just there. And there you have another one.
I see.
Look at that.
This is amazing. No, I mean, like, people see, the problem is that this wealth is never, it doesn't have an economic tag put onto it. No one says that it's worth so much.
Yes.
Or, you know, that this is what.
How many know this? Of course, you don't have its nice red flowers over here. Pitkui.
Pitkui.
And of course, the roots of it are very good. They are again with multivitamins, very good to help build up our immunity. They come this season so that we, you know, the kids, every kid could have a taste of all these things.
Yeah.
And being a child, everyone wants to eat these fruits.
Yeah.
But they did not realize what it was doing to their system, and it was actually helping them, help them fight infections, fight, you know, so many onslaught of so many things that are happening nowadays. And now nobody wants to eat these fruits anymore.
So your Ayurvedic course was good, or it became better because of your interest already in plants? And
I guess it just got accentuated.
I see.
Because of my love for plants. And I have always had plant friends from childhood, so they have always been with me.
So in a certain sense, the religious belief also protects some plants and sacred forest and sacred groves and those
yes.
kind of things.
That is why you have the Devrai.
Yeah.
Many Lord people of know of these sacred groves in the forest,
yeah.
where there is very high vibrational energy in these Devrais, and no one was allowed to cut or pluck anything in the Devrai. So if you required it, it was with permission from the particular priest over there, and you know, certain atonements had to be done, certain offerings had to be given, and then only you could take, because there were certain plants over there that are very useful for incurable diseases. That is the reason why it was so protected, and the vibrational energy, the magnetic energy in that place is very high. A Devrai is always protected by either a king cobra or a cobra.
Really?
Yes, it is a home to these. And there will be always a temperature difference of about 5 to 10 degrees in the daytime.
Yeah.
Compared to outside. Yes.
Really?
Yes, this is proven.
Cooler?
Much, much cooler.
I see. Amazing.
So these are the small little things that you see, and that you... And of course, so the mango tree. Mango is also useful, na?
Right, from its basic coolant properties.
Basic coolant properties. It's also an aphrodisiac. Why do people don't say that?
I see.
So it's also good. So you see, all these things that are there, lots of things died down. We only got them for our taste. But a lot of things in nature help fertility, help us in, you know, building up a particular resistance, which not many people are aware of. So now, even if there is mango during the season, we're told not to have it because it would increase blood sugar. But that's why jambol is there, to help control the blood sugar during the same season.
I see. Interesting.
You have everything available as an antidote.
Yeah.
Now, how many know that if there's a cobra in a place, you will have a plant called a sarpaganda?
I see.
Over there, which is Revolvia serpentina.
I see. And so that could?
That helps you against snake venom.
I see.
And it's also used as a medicine for high BP.
Oh, wow. What checks and balances?
Every check and balance. So there's a balance maintained in nature. Nature knows to maintain its balance.
You grew up with a lot of, days in plants.
I grew up with a lot of plant life. And then, of course...
Your father was a prof of botany, no?
No, he was a physics professor, but then I guess his love for plants and organic farming. And that's where he learned, he himself practiced a bit of permaculture. And that's how I learned my permaculture principles with him. And then today I realized that Ayurveda and permaculture also meet.
Taking it to the next level. Amazing. So your tours actually focus on edible plants or medicinal plants,
medicinal
or both?
Medicinal and edible.
Okay.
Both of them. Now, in this area, we couldn't spot many edible plants.
Yeah.
But yes, there were some of them.
Yeah.
Like this tea. You can even use this as a tea.
Which one?
The same plant that I mentioned that can be used.
Okay.
So you can just steep a tea in the morning for you, and it helps maintain acidity, acid reflux.
My goodness.
So many benefits.
Amazing.
We don't need to reach out for...
But in today's day and age, everyone wants quick remedies. No?
Yes, everyone wants quick remedies. So that's why you need someone to look at your pulse and then tell you exactly which plant suits you.
I see.
That's where the pulse diagnosis comes into effect.
You practice that also?
I practice that too.
I see. It's amazing, no? And in the past, doctors didn't need all these high-tech equipment before.
Yes.
They had this very huge kind of understanding of...
Exactly.
What was going wrong?
Exactly. And if you see, at that time, they were so well advanced. And they, of course, practiced a lot of detoxification.
Yeah.
Now, talking about detoxification, there's this one plant here that has been cut. But the fruit of this plant is used to cause vomiting during this season of spring. And that itself acts as a detoxification. So people who are suffering from asthma, people suffering from allergies, upper respiratory tract disorders, can use the fruit of this plant. But again, you have to do it under the supervision of an Ayurvedic doctor. And it helps you detoxify, especially those who are having psoriasis, eczema, then those who have sleeplessness also, as well as those addicted to alcohol should do a detox of this in the spring. It's really worth it.
They have those, I think in Thailand, no? The centers where they detox you from alcohol and they get them to warm it out.
Yes, and they get them to, we have them in India too.
I see.
So this season is the season for the vomiting, the spring season.
There's so much of knowledge which we don't understand, don't appreciate, or don't legitimatize, no, in that sense.
Yes, yes.
Or delegitimatize too.
I guess if everyone could just be, I'm not saying criticize, but at least give it a thought and open it with welcome arms. There is a system of medicine.
No. We have to wait till it reaches Europe and till it goes into some pharmacy and it comes back to us as a pill. At which stage then we will be willing to pay, like, you know, in ransom for it.
But that's what happens, you know. My foreigner patients know much more about the local plants than our own locals themselves.
Books that were written by these Mangaloreans of Goan origin, Coelho and J.F. Lobo and all that makes sense?
Yes, that does make sense. That does make sense because they tried to preserve at least some of the local knowledge that was there, handed down from grandmother to grandmother, was noted in those books. So yes, it does make sense.
And the last thing, where do you practice and how do people contact you for your tours and when are they?
Okay, I'm available on Instagram as Dr. Marianne Lobo.
One word, Dr. Marianne Lobo?
Yes, Dr. Marianne Lobo,
DR.
One word.
DR.
Yeah, DR Marianne Lobo. MARYANNE LOBO, Lobo. So that's my Instagram handle. Of course, there's Plant Walk Goa Official, which is the other Instagram handle which you can use for the plant walks.
Yeah.
And I consult in Mapsa, very close to the Hanuman Theatre, just behind Lakshmi Narayan Temple.
I see.
Okay, so that's where my clinical practice is. But of course, I'm available online, and I have a page on Facebook called as Ayurveda in Goa.
I see.
So you can get it.
Fantastic, yeah. I think the way you've packaged it and the way you've promoted the concept is really something very innovative.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, really.
And I must not forget to mention that it was you, when I was in standard 11, who helped my poem become public in the newspaper.
Poem. I mean, that's totally relevant.
But I cannot forget
But I'm really grateful to see, you know, so many young Goans doing so many different things and wishing you all the best. And just one last shot of the scenic Saule Lake. Saule Lake. You have to discover more of this part of Bades.
Yes. This is such a beautiful plant. Sorry to say, but I've found it out today myself.
Good. That it can be on your plant walk agenda.
Yes, definitely. It's so beautiful.
Thanks.
Thank you so much, Rico.